Loi Lilei, and welcome to this live Tangata Pasifika special on the Kingdom of Tonga's historic democratic elections. Tonight we'll cross live to Tonga for the latest from the Tangata Pasifika team in the Kingdom, and we'll also talk to Tongans both here in the atrium of TVNZ and in Tonga for in-depth analysis of what happened today. So how is this election different from previous ones? Well, at the last election, there were 9 people's representatives in the Tongan Parliament. This election, there's significant change, with that number growing to 17. There's no change where the nobles are concerned. They keep their 9 representatives. And as for the King, well, in the last election, he handpicked 12 members of the House. In this election, though, he'll have no say on who's elected. Also, in the past, the King decided who will be Prime Minister. Now the elected members of the Legislative Assembly will vote on who will take that top spot in the House. On the whole, the number of seats in the House shrinks from 30 to 26, so quite a few changes there. Now let's go to the Friendly Islands to find out the latest with our senior journalist, John Utanga. John, what's the atmosphere been like on this historic day?
Yes, Malo Lele, Sandra here from Nuku'alofa. Well, it's been a tremendous atmosphere here in Tonga. People turned out in their droves to cast their votes, and all eyes were on Akalisi Pohiva.
He's the man of the moment, Akalisi Pohiva arriving at his local polling booth to cast his vote, aware of the significance this election is for Tonga.
I think it's historical to see that we are now coming towards the end of the old order, and we are looking forward to meet the new political era.
Across town, former Police Minister Clive Edwards was hoping this late rally in the polls will put him ahead of 2 strong challengers.
Reasonably confident, as confident as I can be, but given the uncertainty of any election, I must accept that.
In polling booths across Nuku'alofa, Tongans turned up in a steady stream to have their say, the sense of occasion not lost on voters.
Yeah, there's plenty of excitement going on, and it's just the talk of the town right now. It's on the radio the whole day, and you know, my parents, my little brother is voting. He's never been interested in politics before, and he's done his vote, and he won't tell me who it is. So people are actually taking it seriously.
In the heart of Nuku'alofa, nobles gathered near the palace to nominate the 9 who will represent them. There was plenty of speculation that a noble could end up prime minister.
People have accepted this. You've got 17 people's representatives. And if they, together with the other 9, decide to elect a noble, isn't that democracy?
Well, that is the question. John, what kind of election has it been, though?
It's been actually quite a trouble-free election, except last night we had 2 late withdrawals from a couple of candidates in the Tongatapu 1 electorate, some allegations of some personal problems in regard to debt. Apparently their problems had been known for quite some time, but they were finally withdrew last night. But overall it's been a very uneventful in terms of problems, and a good turnout today.
What about the noble representatives? I mean, what's actually happened there?
Yes, of course, 9 of the members in the House will be nobles. We managed to get around to their voting. They elect among themselves. And the pictures you saw were that closed session today. Interesting makeup of the nobles in this election. 2 of the nobles are new to the job, and there's a bit of excitement around them. One of them is Vaya, Honourable Vaya, whom features in our story later in the show, and the other is the member from Vava'u, and there's a sense that this is a group of nobles who can take Tonga into the future.
Well, we look forward to that. And finally, this question I wanted to ask, especially about the women candidates, I mean, how did they feature in this election?
Well, you know, the sad thing is 11 women candidates stood in this election, but none so far have gotten elected. We still haven't heard any results from the seats outside of Tongatapu, but on Tongatapu itself, none of the women candidates have come through.
All right, well, thanks for that, John. We'll come back to you soon, and we'll discuss about those women candidates also with our panel. But now, some of the results from today. to appreciate just how significant these changes are, let's look back now at the rich history of Tongan rule. Adrian Stevenon has this report.
Tonga has one of the last remaining monarchies in the Pacific today, a lineage which goes back 1,100 years. The current monarch, King Seelsi Tupou V, is descended from King George Tupou I, the man who united warring factions and founded the modern kingdom in the late 1800s. In 1875, Tupou I enacted far-reaching changes under a new constitution. He declared Tonga a constitutional monarchy, freed the common people from virtual enslavement by their chiefs, and enshrined a new code of law, land tenure, and freedom of the press.
He had something within him that that drove him, that allowed him to see these things without being able to know what are these foreign values, what are these foreign institutions.
Despite a history of reform, Tonga's lack of reform has been its undoing in modern times. While Queen Salote was revered by her people, her son inherited a kingdom in a time of much social and economic change. Under King Taufa'ahau Tupou IV, Tonga reached out to the world to secure its economic future. But as the king tried to propel Tonga into the modern era, political reform remained off the agenda. It was under his reign that the first clear signs of dissent emerged in the kingdom.
1975 was when the first initial thinking was there. And of course, you've got people like Akilisi Pohiva. So Akilisi entered parliament in 1987. But then you begin to see commoners getting involved in the dialogue, in the discussion, and the push to have more democracy.
Under Taufa'ahau, a succession of blunders and failed investment schemes marred his reign. There was the selling of Tongan passports, the plan to dump nuclear waste in Tonga, and the theft of millions of dollars by an American advisor, the self-styled court jester. Government was coming under increasing criticism from the growing pro-democracy voice and the independent media. The government's response: tie dissenters up in court, throw the newspaper editors in jail.
There are adjustments that had to be made. The reformers were demanding and saying, we've got to bring these changes about. The whole country, what they're used to, you know, it's any kind of reform takes a while to have mental adjustments to it and to adjust their thinking to it. And that's what happened in the 1990s.
By 2002, 7 of the 9 people's representatives in parliament were pro-democracy supporters. In 2003, government passed a law to muzzle the press. This led to a march down the main street in the capital. Pro-democracy supporters kept up the pressure, and in 2005, Tonga was crippled by more protest action. This time, it was a civil service strike. By now, the king was very much a hands-off monarch, as his ill health kept him out of the public eye. Early in 2006, businessman and people's representative Feleti Sevele was appointed prime minister. It was seen as part of the process of change. In September 2006, King Taufa'ahau Tupou IV died. Despite the outpouring of grief, there was still plenty of unfinished business as far as pro-democracy supporters were concerned. When government tried to adjourn parliament for the year without addressing reforms, anger exploded onto the streets of Nuku'alofa. Government buildings, offices, and shops were looted and burnt. 8 people died in the riots. A state of emergency was declared as Tonga set about healing.
People have been waiting far too long for government to show up. Because there have been signs of times. There were signs on the wall, but I think His Majesty and government failed. They completely failed to read the signs of time.
In the aftermath of the riots, the state of emergency remained, but reform was back on the agenda. In July 2008, 3 days after his coronation, King Seelsi Tupou V announced he would give up most of his powers and be guided by the Prime Minister. In November the following year, the Constitutional and Electoral Commission put forward its proposals for reform. A month later, the government presented to Parliament its reform preferences in time for the 2010 election.
So, an interesting look into how far Tonga has come. All right, let's cross again now to John Utanga in Tongatapu. John, you've spent the week with some of the leaders of the Tongan pro-democracy movement. How much of today is really a victory for them?
Well, the fact that we actually came to today, you know, an election under a new constitution is already a victory for those pro-democracy supporters. As we'll see in the results to come, there's even more to celebrate. For the man who's been the head or the face of the pro-democracy movement here in Tonga, I mean, he's so excited about the future.
Tongans have embraced these elections like never before. For the man who's fought the pro-democracy fight for over 20 years, the rules under which these elections are held are a welcome change.
We have to organize ourselves. We have to stand together. We have to follow, a memorandum of understanding so that we can start with a good and well-organized form of government.
Pohiba's likely to win his seat and is confident his alliance of pro-democracy candidates can win the lion's share of the 17 people's seats on offer because they've been upfront with voters.
They want quick recovery of our economy. And we made it clear to the public that we don't expect the new government to perform a miracle.
But winning seats won't be Pohiba's only problem if he gets to form a government after the elections. He'll also have to contend with the nine nobles.
The nobles will be the ones that will determine who is going to be the prime minister. Most probably the prime minister will be a commoner. Most probably it will be somebody from the people's representatives. But the nobles will have a very strong say in that.
As for the nobles, their role in a future government has them excited.
There is more than excitement. This is a historic occasion. So I think there is a lot of jostling to be a member of parliament from the nobility's side.
In the meantime, Pohiba's not discounting a role in government, even the top job, if his alliance comes through.
If we can have 14 seats, it's our party who will select the prime minister.
You ready for that?
Oh, yes.
All right, John, we're dying to know, how has it worked out for Akelisi and his alliance? Did he get the 14 seats he was after?
Well, so far we can't tell you that because some of the results from the seats outside of Tongatapu haven't come through. But on Tongatapu itself, he's taken 8 of the 10 seats here, which is quite unexpected for many observers of this election. For the man himself, he had no equivocation. He was fairly confident he'll get those 17 seats. But, you know, it's fairly difficult to see, given that there's a support not for him up in Vava'u, so he might fall short of his 14. He might get about 12, probably.
All right, John, well, thanks for your hard work. And don't go away, because we have more results and the people's reaction towards the Kingdom of Tonga's first democratic elections live after the break. Welcome back to the Live Tangata Pasifika special on the Tongan elections. Here are the results we have so far. And joining me on the panel to discuss today's historic occasion are representatives from the Tongan community here. Dr. Sitaligi, what are your thoughts on it so far?
I think it's fantastic that now that Tonga can, the ancient Tongan democracy could move to another level.
Okay, well, we're going to discuss this more with the panel in our third section, but now to get a grassroots perspective on what today means for the kingdom, our Tongan reporter John Bulu has been on the ground gauging reaction throughout the week. He joins me now from Tongatapu. John, how have you found the whole experience?
Maloe tau lava saja, maloe lau maria ho eki mo tonga ko tonga mea mai ke polo kalama e fiafini. As a Tongan and a journalist, I'm very proud to be here in Tonga to be sharing this historic event taking place with our people and especially in our nation. I've been out and about with our locals, finding out what they thought about what they think about the election, and here's what they had to say.
It's early morning in Talamahu Market's in full swing. But the shop talks not about the price of dalo and kumala, it's their upcoming election. You see, locals here know all about a good deal, and many say so far the government's only given them a bad one.
I don't trust the government, no. Because remember, we don't work for them, but we pay tax. Only one thing I don't like because they don't fix the road.
Standard of living in Tonga, fuma mafa a pite koloa, ange ko uhila pe moe vai.
Across town at the Kava Club in Kolomotu'a, the talk around the Kava circle seems to be a common one. More power to the common people.
We whakarere koe whanua ki mu ahaia, o ku mi mei ke pesete o na noa, pe ke pesete fit noa. Ai whai tūtou ni pē, ai pureanga, ui wha o atohare o kakai, pe wanga whee whee, kani koe, ono whakarere.
But out on the streets, there's more excitement.
Tonga's move into democracy has been described as sleepwalking, but this election has injected some pace. Now they're driving their way into the future.
These Tongans eager to embrace this moment of change.
I just want people to get involved in nation building, you know, because this is their nation, it's for them, and if they don't get involved, they're only going to moan and complain about, you know, whoever goes in, and it's good for Tonga.
Out in the back blocks of Tongatapu, far from the campaign hype, Sayanono's just getting on with his life. His hopes and those for his grandsons are quite simple.
Family. Me mawinga ang bege. Kala la kape fonua gi olunga. Ha ha me wele le ya fonua. Me pia mawinga teo.
This historic election and the hope it brings has lifted the spirits of so many people I've met, including former MP Papilo Fuliaki. And even though the King's copped a bad rap in the past, she credits him for setting Tonga on a positive path.
The King, it's very smart. The King is very confident. For him to say, well, if you're ready, I'll give you my power. If you're ready to handle the executive of the country, go for it.
And going for it is very much on the minds of Tonga's 33 nobles, 9 of whom will be elected by their peers to sit in the new government. For them, this election is a chance to prove that they can be the stabilising force in Tongan politics.
The nobles have dominated the parliament because of their numbers and their appointments, and they have been a stabilising factor for the development of politics within Tonga. Now, with the elections coming up, the nobility's role will be far greater than their loyalties prior over the last 130 years to the government.
So as Tonga gears up for another crowning moment, it seems that people are ready to make use of their power that comes with the vote.
John Bulu reporting from Tongatapu there. Well, stay with us as we join our panel here in Auckland for more comment on the 2010 Tongan elections.